clownfish, who lived on the Great Barrier Reef with his dad. He was eager to start school and learn about the wonders of the ocean. But little did Nemo know that both he and his dad were about to embark on an amazing adventure. If you want to hear the story, you can read along with me in your book. You'll know it's time to turn the page when you hear this sound. Let's begin now. Deep in the ocean off the coast of Australia, a clownfish named Marlin showed his wife Coral their new home, a cozy anemone perched on a steep cliff called the drop-off.
So you do like it, don't you?
We're gonna wake the kids.
Coral gazed at a nearby grotto that was filled with hundreds of fish eggs.
We still have to name them. Good name.
The couple played and teased each other, sharing their dreams of parenthood. As Marlin watched, Coral swam on sight, straight into the view of a hungry duck. Coral, worried about the eggs, edged toward the grotto. Marlin tried to stop her.
Just get inside, you right there.
Coral broke for the grotto. The barracuda attacked. Marlin tried to block the hungry fish, but was knocked against the cliff. Everything went black. Looking to, there was only silence.
Coral!
The grotto was empty, and Coral was no home. Then he saw a single egg, slightly damaged. Marlin cradled the egg in his fin.
I promise I'll never let anything happen to you. Nemo.
As time passed, Nemo grew into a happy young fish that was curious about everything.
Hello there, sea turtles.
His father smiled.
You know what, if I ever meet a sea turtle, I'll ask.
Nemo longed for adventure, but Marlin, determined to protect him, barely let Nemo out of his sight. On Nemo's first day of school, Marlin panicked when the old class was going on a field trip to the drop-off. Swimming after them, he heard Nemo and his new friends daring each other to swim out over the edge. Marlin called out to his son.
Nemo! You know you can't swim well.
I can swim fine now, okay?
No, it's not okay. You know what? This gets going in here.
Nemo glared at him. In defiance, Nemo darted out toward a boat on the surface. His father yelled after him.
Get back here! I said get back here now!
As Nemo swam, a diver appeared behind him. Nemo screamed. Marlin tried to help, but was blinded by a bright flash. It was a second diver taking pictures. The first diver pulled out a net bag and caught him. Then the two divers returned to the boat and sped off, accidentally knocking one of their masks overboard. Marlin shouted as he chased after the boat.
Nemo! Nemo now! No!
Marlin searched frantically.
Has anybody seen a boat? Please!
He bumped into a blue tang named Dory, who offered to help. When Marlin followed, Dory whirled around.
Stop following me, okay?
What are you talking about? You're showing me between the boat ramps.
Dory shook her head sadly.
I'm so sorry. See, I suffer from short-term memory loss.
Figuring Dory would be of no help, Marlin turned to leave and found himself face to face with a shark. Sharp bared his razor-like teeth and invited the two fish to a get-together with his friends. Marlin tried to decline, but Dory wouldn't hear of it.
You mean like a party?
Oh, you party?
The shark took them to a sunken ship surrounded by floating sea mines. Inside were two other sharks, and together they recited a pledge. As they spoke, Marlin glanced up and saw a familiar object. It was the diver's mask. Marlin told the sharks what had happened to Nemo. The first shark, whose name was Bruce, couldn't help but feel sorry. While Bruce sniffled, Marlin noticed writing on the net. Could this be a clue to finding Nemo? Dory got excited.
Well, then we gotta find a place they can read it.
She grabbed the mask, but bumped her nose, and Bruce got a whiff of it. Friends tried to stop him. Bruce chased Marlin and Dory through the ship. They escaped with the mask by launching a torpedo in Bruce's mouth. Unfortunately, he spit out the torpedo and it hit the surrounding sea lions. There was a huge explosion. Miles away, Nemo found himself in a fish tank at a dentist's office with a goofy gang of tropical fish. All of them had come from pet stores except for the leader, Gil. Like Nemo, Gil had grown up in the ocean, and he had a damaged fin from his attempts to escape the tank. The gang and their friend Nigel, a pelican, amused themselves by watching the dentist work. Approaching the tank, the dentist showed Nemo a photo of Darla, his 7-year-old niece.
She's gonna be here Friday to pick you up. You're in prison. Yeah.
The fish gasped. Darla was a fish killer. That night, Nemo's new friends held a ceremony at the tanks of the bubbling volcano led by Blunt, the blowfish.
Nemo, you have been called forth to the summit of Mount Guanahatahogi to join with us in the fraternal bonds of Tank. If you are able to swim through the ring of fire!
A ring of bubbles shot out, and Nemo swam through. Cheering, the fish named him Shark Bait. Gil swam forward.
Okay, Shark Bait's one of us. Agree? We're gonna get him out of here. We're gonna have them escape.
Gil explained. If they could jam the filter, the dentist would have to clean the tank. When he put the fish in plastic bags, they could escape by rolling up the window and into the harbor. The next day, Gil saw the dentist leave the room.
That's the cue, Shark Bait.
Swimming to the surface, Nemo leaped into the filter and wedged a pebble between the gears. The fan stopped, shutting down the filter.
I got it!
But as Nemo swam to escape, the pebble came loose, and the filter started up again, sucking Nemo toward the fan blades. Gil yanked the plank from the tank floor and fed it into the filter. Nemo grabbed the tip of it, and the gang pulled it to safety. Gil knew he could never risk Nemo's life again.
We're done.
Beneath the ocean, Marlin and Dory had survived the submarine explosion, but the diver's mask had fallen into a deep crevice. Swimming into the darkness, they saw a light. It was a lure on the antenna of a vicious anglerfish. As the hungry fish closed in, it lit up the sea floor. There was the mask. Suddenly, Dory remembered she could read human. Marlin courageously held the light while she read.
P-Sherman
2212,
Dewey City.
And Marlin cried out. The anglerfish crashed above them, wedging itself between the mask and a rock. Marlin breathed a sigh of relief. They were still alive. Escaping the crevice, Marlin and Dory spotted a school of moonfish. The moonfish liked Dory and entertained her with impressions of a lobster, a cruise ship. Even Marlin, when asked, her new friends provided directions to Sydney.
What you want to do is follow the EAC. It's east of Australia current. That direction.
Marlin and Dory headed for the EAC, but in their path was a forest of dead jellyfish. Marlin made it through, but a jellyfish stung Dory and trapped her in its tentacles. Marlin pulled her out, but the stings had made her weak and tired. The last thing he saw was the silhouette of a giant sea turtle. When Marlin came to, he was lying on a sea turtle's shell. The turtle spoke.
Yeah. Name's Crush. Okay, Crush.
friend Squirt, who was playing with Dory. When they finished playing, Marlin told Squirt the story of his search for Nemo.
I live on this reef, a long, long way from here.
Squirt told the story to a lobster, the lobster told the dolphin, and soon the moon spread all the way to Sydney, where Nigel the pelican heard it. Nigel sped to the dentist's office to tell Nemo.
Your dad has been spending the entire desert looking for you, and the word is he's headed this way, right now, to Sydney.
Nigel nodded.
That's it, Marlin, go to the conference room.
Really?
Inspired, Nemo grabbed the pebble and leaped into the filter again. This time, the pebble stuck, stopping the filter. Gil and the others cheered. Now the tank fish had to get the tank dirty, so the dentist would have to clean it. Outside Sydney, Marlin and Dory said goodbye to the sea turtles and left the EAC. Despite Marlin's best efforts to stop her, Dory asked a whale for directions in whale talk. As the whale swam closer, hundreds of screaming shrimp raced past. But it was too late. Marlin and Dory were swept into the whale's mouth. Marlin was upset. He had come too far to end his trip like this. Dory, meanwhile, remained optimistic. As the whale raised his tongue, she asked him what was going on.
He said, it's time to let go! Everything's gonna be
alright! Marlin gulped and let go. They shot down the whale's throat and up the spout, high into the air. Before them lay the skyline of Sydney. In the dentist's office, the tank fish woke up Friday morning to a shocking sight. The tank was clean. The filter had been changed during the night, ruining their escape plan. To make matters worse, the dentist slipped a net into the water, capturing Nemo. Gil, thinking fast, charged into the net and shouted to Nemo.
Swim down!
He did, pulling down the net, and they escaped. But as Nemo fled, he swam straight into a plastic bag the dentist was holding. As the dentist lifted him up, the office door slammed open with a crash. Darla had arrived. In Sydney Harbor, Marlin searched for the boat that took Nemo.
Come on, Dory, we're gonna find it.
Suddenly, a pelican dove from the sky and scooped them up in its beak. It landed on a pier and tried to swallow them. Marlin wedged himself in its throat.
No! I am coming this far to eat breakfast!
The pelican coughed. His friend Nigel came to help him, and out flopped the fish. Marlin gasped.
I gotta find my son Nemo!
Nigel grinned.
Hey, I know we are sent.
But he wasn't the only one watching. A flock of hungry seagulls swooped down on Marlin and Dory. Nigel rescued them and sped off toward the city.
Everybody hold on!
The dentist, meanwhile, greeted Darla. But when he reached for the plastic bag, he saw Nemo inside, apparently dead. Nemo was
late.
Then the gang cheered.
He's gonna get flushed down the toilet! He's gonna get out of here!
But the dentist headed to the trash can instead.
Oh, no, not the trash can! Nemo, no!
There was a crash, and Nigel came hurtling through the window with Marlin and Dory in his beak. Surprised, the dentist dropped the bag, and it sprang a leak. Marlin peered out of Nigel's beak. He saw Nemo floating upside down in the bag.
Nemo!
The dentist grabbed Nigel's throat and closed his beak, trapping Marlin and Dory inside. Then he hurled Nigel out the window. Nemo looked up.
Daddy? Daddy?
But it was too late. His father was gone. Just then, Darla reached for the bag and shook it. Gil called to the others.
Trip to the top of Mount Wanahakaluki!
The gang tilted the volcano, and Gil swam inside.
Bring up fire!
Jacques, the cleaner shrimp, turned on the air bubbles. And Gil shot from the tank, landing on Darla's head. He screamed, dropping Nemo onto a dental mirror. Gil dove onto the other end, flipping Nemo into the sink, down the drain.
Hell, you're dead. I said, hurry.
Nigel, shut out of the office, return to the harbor. He dropped Marlin and Dory into the water.
I'm so sorry. Truly, I am.
Nigel flew off, and Marlin swam out to sea, leaving Dory.
I'm going home.
As Marlin left, Nemo emerged from a nearby hike. He spotted Dory swimming in circles.
Are you all right? I think I lost somebody back. I can't remember.
I'm Nemo.
He told her he was looking for someone, too. They could look together. It wasn't until Dory saw the word Sydney on a pipe that she remembered who he was. Her eyes opened wide.
You're Nemo!
You're my father!
This way! Quick!
They searched for Marlin, finding him in the nearby fishing grounds. A big net was dropped into the water. Marlin and Nemo escaped the net, but Dory wasn't so lucky.
Help!
Nemo thought of the net at the dentist's office.
We have to put all the fish in there together! I can do this!
Marlin tried to stop him.
No, I am not going to lose you again!
But watching Nemo, Marlin saw that his son had changed. And so had he.
You're right. I know you can.
Nemo grinned at his father.
Look at me!
Now go! Hurry!
As the net rose, Nemo swam up inside.
We have to tell everybody!
Swim down together! Swim down!
It was Marlin, just outside, helping spread the word. The fish swam down. Little by little, the net stopped rising and began to move down. Finally, it broke off from the boat. Dory and the others were free. But one fish was missing. On the ocean floor, Nemo lay trapped beneath the net. Marlin and Dory raced over and lifted the net, but Nemo didn't move. Marlin gasped.
Nemo! Nemo?
The little clownfish lay motionless. Then, after a moment, he coughed.
Daddy.
Marlin sighed.
Thank goodness.
Daddy, I
hate
you.
I'm so sorry.
Nemo reached out and touched his father's fin. Marlin grinned.
Guess what? Sea turtles. I had met one, and he was 150 years old.
Several weeks later, Nemo was back home and ready for school. This time, so was Marlin. They raced to the bus stop, where an exchange student greeted with the other kids. It was Squirt!
I'm from the EAC, dude!
Three sharks passed by overhead. They parted to reveal Dory.
Thanks, guys.
Her friend Bruce grinned back.
We'll see you next week.
Dory swam beside Marlin and Nemo waved goodbye.
Bye, Dad. Oh, wait, I forgot something.
He swam back and hugged Marlin.
Love you, Dad.
Marlin smiled.
I love you too, son. Now go have an adventure.